John Fitzgerald Kennedy was the 35th President of the United States. On November 22nd, 1963, he was assassinated in his limousine in Dealey Plaza in Dallas, Texas. The official government findings of the Warren Commission were that Lee Harvey Oswald, acting alone, killed President Kennedy.
Robert Francis Kennedy, the Attorney General, under his older brother Jack. Privately, Bobby expressed doubts about the findings of the Warren Commission.
Lyndon Baines Johnson was Vice President of the United States. Within an hour of Kennedy's death, he was sworn in as president in his home state of Texas. Johnson ordered the Texas officials to halt their inquiry and turn the investigation over to J. Edgar Hoover, Johnson's dear friend, neighbor, and regular dinner companion.
J. Edgar Hoover controlled the investigation of the assassination as executive director of the FBI. After the 1964 election, Hoover would be past the mandatory federal retirement age, and he feared that Kennedy would force him out of a job he had held since 1924. After JFK's assassination, Johnson signed an executive order giving Hoover his job for life. Hoover, who was homosexual, gathered information about the sex lives of many, including homosexuals, and use this information against these often innocent Americans.
Clyde Tolson was the top-level director of the FBI, J. Edgar Hoover's right-hand man and constant companion. They worked together, vacationed together, lived together, and are buried next to each other.
Jacqueline Bouvier Kennedy was the wife of John F. Kennedy. She was riding in the limousine during the assassination. Although she was wary of the trip to Dallas, she publicly stated that she believed the findings of the Warren Commission. She never made a public statement of what occurred in Dallas.
Lady Bird Johnson was from a very wealthy Texas family. Her power was broad-reaching, including owning numerous radio and television stations. On November 22, 1963, she became the First Lady of the United States.
Evelyn Lincoln was personal secretary to JFK for 12 years. She warned the president against going to Dallas.
Alan Dulles was director of the Central Intelligence Agency until he was fired by John Kennedy following that Bay of Pigs fiasco in 1961. President Johnson chose Dulles as a member of the Warren Commission, that blue ribbon panel investigating John Kennedy's assassination.
Clint Murchison Sr. was a noted Texas oil magnate and political operative. In 1952, he and Hoover worked together to mount a smear campaign against Democratic presidential candidate Adlai Stevens. Hoover and his close companion Clyde Tolson invested heavily in Murchison's oil business.
McGeorge Bundy was national security advisor to Presidents Kennedy and Johnson from 1961 to 1966. He is known primarily for his role in escalating the U.S. involvement in Vietnam, something Jack Kennedy had decided against.
Carlos Marcello was mafia chief in New Orleans. He was deported by Robert Kennedy in 1961, worked his way back into the U.S., and on November 22nd was facing another deportation trial. On the idea of killing Bobby Kennedy, he said, "A dog will continue to bite you if you cut off its tail, but if you cut off the dog's head, he will cease to cause trouble."
Major General Edwin Walker was a right-wing military man and a member of the John Birch Society. Jack Kennedy forced his resignation. Bobby Kennedy had him committed to a mental institution for his part in the University of Mississippi riots. Walker is responsible for the wanted for treason leaflets passed out along the motorcade route in Dallas.
Governor John Connally of Texas was riding in the presidential limousine. His five wounds and two shattered bones, along with two of Kennedy's wounds, were all said to be caused by one bullet, a theory vital to proving a lone gunman. But there were more bullet fragments left in Connally's body than are missing from this magic bullet. He testified to the Warren Commission, "Well, there is my absolute knowledge that one bullet caused the president's first wound. Then an entirely separate shot struck me.
Jack Valenti, rode in the motorcade in Dallas. After the assassination, he flew with the new president to Washington, where he served as LBJ's first special assistant. He even slept in the White House the first 2 months of Johnson's presidency.
Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize for advancing civil rights through nonviolent methods. J. Edgar Hoover waged a war against King as a communist, personally supervised invasive surveillance of him, and even wrote an anonymous letter suggesting King should commit suicide.
Lee Harvey Oswald was an ex-Marine radar control operator who defected to the Soviet Union in 1959, announcing his U.S. citizenship. At the height of the Cold War, Oswald was allowed to return to the U.S. with his Soviet wife and daughter. The Warren Commission stated Oswald, acting alone, killed the president. While Oswald was in the Texas School Book Depository at the time of the assassination, paraffin tests and eyewitness accounts make it virtually impossible that he fired the shots that killed Kennedy!
What all the rest lack. Everyone wants to back Jack. Jack is on the right track, 'cause he's got high hopes. He's got high hopes. 1960, he's the year in for him.
I shall remember when Jack says do this, it is performed.
Set on and leave no ceremony out.
Mr. President.
Who is it that calls on me?
Mr. President, beware Dallas.
What takes out of me now? Speak once again.
Beware Dallas, Texas.
Ms. Lincoln, you're a dreamer. Let us leave this. Lincoln! Did you observe me now of late? I have not from your eyes that gentleness and show of love as I was wont to have. You bear too stubborn and too strange a hand of your friend that loves you.
Be not deceived, Edgar. If I veiled my look, I turn the trouble of my countenance merely upon myself. Vexed I am of late with passions of some difference, conceptions only proper to myself, which give some soil perhaps to my behaviors. But let not therefore my good friends be grieved, among which number, Edgar, be you one? Nor construe any further my neglect than that poor Johnson, with himself at war, forgets the shows of love to other men.
Then, Lyndon, I have much mistook your passion, by means whereof this breast of mine hath buried thoughts of great value, worthy cogitations. Tell me, good Lyndon, can you see your face?
No, Edgar, for the eye sees not itself, but by reflection. By some other thing.
'Tis just. And it is very much lamented, Lyndon, you have no such mirrors as will turn your hidden worthiness into your eye, that you might see your shadow. I have heard where many of the best respect in Washington, except immortal Kennedy, speaking of Johnson and groaning underneath this age's yoke, have wished that noble Johnson had his eyes.
Into what dangers would you lead me, Edgar? That you would have deceived to myself that which is not in me.
Then, Lyndon, be prepared to hear. And since you know you cannot see yourself so well as by my reflection, I, your glass, will modestly discover to yourself that of yourself which you yet know not of. And be not jealous on me, gentle Lyndon, if you know that I do fawn on men and hug them hard and after scandal them. Then hold me dangerous.
What means this?
Yeah.
I do fear the people choose Kennedy for their king.
Aye, do you fear it? Then must I think you would not have it so.
I will not, Edgar. yet I love him well. But wherefore do you hold me here so long? What is it you would impart to me? If it be aught for the general good, set honor in one eye and death in the other, and I will look on both indifferently. For let our God so speed me as I love the name of honor more than I fear death.
I know that virtue to be in you, gentlemen, and as well as I do know your outward favor. Well, honor is the subject of my story. I cannot tell what you and the other men think of this life, but for my single self, I would as lief not be as live to be in awe of such a thing as I myself. I was born as free as Kennedy, so are you. We both have fed as well, and we can both endure the winter's cold as well as he. And this womanizer is now become a god. And Hoover is a wretched creature and must bend his body if Kennedy carelessly but nod on him. My God, it doth amaze me. A man of such a feeble temper should so get the start of the majestic world and bear the palm alone?
Another kindle shout. I do believe these applauses are for some new honors that are heaped on Kennedy.
Why, man, he doth bestride the narrow world like a colossus, while we petty men walk under his huge legs and peep about to find ourselves dishonorable graves. Men at some time are masters of their fates. The fault, dear Lyndon, is not in our stars, but in ourselves that we are underlings. Johnson and Kennedy, what should be in that canon? Why should that name be sounded more than yours? Write them together, yours is as fair a name. Sound them, it doth befit the mouth as well. Weigh them, it is as heavy. Conjure with them. Johnson will start a spirit as soon as Kennedy. Now in the name of all the gods at once, upon what meat does this our Jack feed that he is grown so great? Age, thou art chained. Washington, thou hast lost the breed of noble bloods. When could they say, till now, the talked of Washington that her wide walks encompassed but one man? Now, is it Washington, indeed, and room enough if there is in it, but only one man? Oh, you and I have heard our fathers say, there was a Johnson once that would have brooked the eternal devil to keep his state in Washington as easily as a king.
That you do love me. I am nothing jealous. What you would work me to, I have some aim. How I think of this and of these times, I shall recount hereafter. For this present, I would not, so with love I might entreat you, be any further moved. What you have said, I will consider. What you have to say, I will with patience hear, and find the time both meet to hear and answer such high things. Till then, my noble friend, chew upon this. Johnson had rather be a villager than to repute himself a Texas boy. Under these hard conditions, as this time is like to lay upon us.
I am glad that my weak words have struck but this much show of fire from Lyndon Baines Johnson.
Bobby?
Jack.
Let me have men about me that are fat, sleek-headed men, and such as sleep o' nights. Yon Hoover has a lean and hungry look. He knows too much. Such men are dangerous.
Fear him not, Jack. He's not dangerous.
I would he were fatter, but I fear him not. Yet if my name were liable to fear, I do not know the man I should avoid so soon as that J. Edgar. He reads much, he's a great observer, and he looks quite through the deeds of men. He loves no plays as thou dost, Bobby. He hears no music. Seldom he smiles. Smiles in such a sort as if he'd mocked himself and scorned his spirit that he could be moved to smile at anything. Oh, such men as he be never at hot seas whilst they behold a greater than themselves, and therefore are they dangerous. I rather tell thee what is to be feared than what I fear, for always I am Jack Kennedy.
Well,
Lyndon, thou art noble, yet I see thy honorable medal may be wrought from that it is disposed. Therefore, 'tis meet that noble minds keep ever with their likes. For who so firm that cannot be seduced? Jack doth bear me hard, but he loves Lyndon. If I were Johnson now, and he were Edgar, he should not humor me. And after this, let President Kennedy seat him sure, for we will shake him, or worse days endure.
Who's there?
An American?
Dulles, by your voice.
Your ear is good, Edgar. What night is this?
A very pleasing night to honest men.
Whoever knew, the heavens menace so.
You are dull, Alan. And those sparks of life that should be in an American you do want,
or else
you use not. You look pale.
Gaze and put on fear and cast yourself in wonder to see the strange impatience of the heavens. But if you would consider the true cause, why all these fires, why all these gliding ghosts, why birds and beasts from quality and kind, why old men, fools, and children calculate, why all these things change from their ordinance, their nature, and preformed faculties to monstrous quality, why you would find that heaven hath infused them with these spirits to make them instruments of fear and warning unto some monstrous state. Now could I, Alan, name thee a man most like this dreadful knife that thunders, lightens, opens graves, and roars as doth a hawk in the capital? A man no mightier than myself or me in private action, yet prodigious grown, and fearful as these strange eruptions are.
Miss Kennedy, what you mean, is it not?
Let it be who it is. For Americans now have thews and limbs like unto their ancestors. But woe the while, our fathers' minds are dead. We are governed by our mother spirits. Our yoke and sufferance show us womanish.
Indeed. They say in 64 the voters mean to establish Kennedy as king.
I know where I will wear this pistol then. Hoover from bondage will deliver Hoover. Therein, dear God, you make the weak most strong. Therein, dear God, you tyrants do defeat. Nor stony tower, nor walls of beaten brass, nor airless dungeon, nor strong links of iron can be retentive to the strength of spirit. But life, being weary of these worldly bars, never lacks power to dismiss itself. If I know this, know all the world besides. That part of tyranny that I do bear, I can shake off at pleasure.
So can I. So every bondman by his own hand bears the power to cancel his captivity.
And why should Kennedy be a tyrant then? Poor man. I know he would not be a wolf, but that he sees that Americans are but sheep. Even no lion but not Americans' hinds. Those that with haste will make a mighty fire, begin it with weak straws. What trash is America, what rubbish and what offal, when it serves for the base matter to illuminate so vile a thing as John Kennedy! But oh, grief, where hast thou led me? I perhaps speak this before a willing bondman.
You speak to Dulles? And to such a man there is no fleering telltale. Hold my hand. Be factious for redress of all these griefs, and I will set this foot of mine as far as who goes modest.
There's a bargain made.
Now you know, Alan.
I have moved already some certain of the noblest-minded Americans to undergo with me an enterprise of honorable, dangerous consequence. And I do know, by this, they stay for me at Lincoln's memorial. For now, this dreadful night, there is no stir or walking in the streets, and the complexion of the element in favor is like the work we have in hand, most bloody, fiery, and most terrible.
Stand close a while. Here comes one in haste.
'Tis Murkison. I do know him by his gait. He is a friend.
Clint! Where haste you so?
Find out you. Who's that? Carlos Marcel?
No, it is Dulles, one incorporate to our attempts. Am I not stayed for, Clint?
I'm glad.
What a fearful night is this.
Am I not stayed for?
Yes, you are. Oh, Edgar, if you could but win the noble Johnson to our party.
Be you content, good Clint. We pair to Lincoln's monument, where you will find us. Come, Dulles. You and I will yet ere day see Johnson at his house. Three parts of him is ours already, and the man entire, upon the next encounter, yields him ours.
He sits high in all the people's hearts. That which would appear offense in us, his countenance like richest alchemy shall change to virtue
and to worthiness. Him and his worth and our great need of him you have right well conceited. Let us go, for it is after midnight, and ere day we will awake him. And be sure of it.
It must be by his death. For my part, I don't know personal cause to spurn at him, but for the general,
he would be crowned. Now that might change his nature. There's a question. It is a bright day that brings forth the adder, and that craves wary walking. Crowning that, and then, I grant, we put a sting in him that at his will he may do danger with. The abuse of greatness is when he disjoins remorse from power. And to speak truth of John F., I have not known when his affections swayed more than his reason. But 'tis a common proof that lowliness is young ambition's ladder, whereto the climber upward turns his face. And when he once attains the utmost rung, he then, under the ladder, turns his back, looks in the clouds, scorning the base degrees by which he did ascend. So Kennedy may fashion it thus, that what he is, augmented, would run to these and these extremities, and therefore think him as a serpent's egg, which hatched would, as his kind, grow mischievous and kill him in a shell. Since Hoover first did wet me against Kennedy, I have not slept. Between the acting of a dreadful thing and the first motion, all the interim is like a phantasm or a hideous dream. The genius and the mortal instruments are then in council, and the state of man, like to a little kingdom, suffers then the nature of an insurrection.
Sir, 'tis Director Hoover at the door who doth desire to see you.
Is he alone?
No, sir, there are more with him.
You know?
No, sir, their hats are plucked about their ears, and half their faces buried in their cloaks, that by no means I may discover them by any mark of favor.
Let him enter.
I think we are too bold upon your rest. Good morrow, Linden. Do we trouble you?
I've been up this hour, awake all night. Know all these men that come along with you?
Yes, every man of them. And no man here but honors you. And every one doth wish you had but that opinion of yourself that every noble American bears of you. This is Clint Murkison.
Is welcome here.
This Nick George Bundy?
Is welcome too. You're all welcome. What watchful cares do interpose themselves betwixt your eyes and night?
Shall I entreat a word?
Give me your hands, all over, one by one.
Let us swear our resolution.
No, not an oath. Not the face of men, the sufferings of our souls, the times abuse. If these be motives weak, break up betimes, and every man hence to his idle bed. So let high-sided tyranny rage on till each man drop by lottery. But if these, as I am sure they do, bear fire enough to kindle cowards and to steal with valor the melting spirits of women, then, countrymen, what need we any spur but our own cause to prick us to redress? What other bond than Americans that have spoke the word and will not palter? What other oath than honesty to honesty engaged that this shall be or we will fall for it? Swear, priests. Cowards and men cautious, old feeble carrions and such suffering souls as welcome wrongs, and to bad causes swear such creatures as men doubt, but do not stain the even virtue of our enterprise, nor the insuppressive metal of our spirits, to think that or our cause or our performance did need an oath. When every drop of blood that every American bears, and nobly bears, is guilty of a several bastardy if he do break the smallest particle of any promise which hath passed from him.
Chief Justice Earl Warren, shall we sound him? I think he will stand very strong with us.
Oh, let us not leave him out.
No, by no means.
Oh, let us have him, for his silver hairs will purchase us a good opinion and buy men's voices to commend our deeds.
Shall no man else be touched, but only John Kennedy?
McGeorge, well urged. I think it is not meet Bobby, so well beloved of Jack, should outlive him. We shall find of him a shrewd contriver, and you know his means. If he improve them, they will stretch so far as to annoy us all. Which to prevent, let Bobby and Jack fall together.
Our course will seem too bloody, dear Hoover, to cut the head off and then hack at the limbs like wrath in death and envy afterwards. For Bobby is but a limb of John. Let's be sacrificers, not butchers, Edgar. We all stand up against the spirit of Kennedy. And in the spirit of men, there is no blood. Come by Kennedy's spirit and not dismember him. Alas, Jack must bleed for it. And gentle friends, let's kill him boldly, but not wrathfully. Let's carve him as a dish fit for our God, not hew him as a carcass fit for hounds. Let our hearts, as subtle masters do, stir up their servants to an act of rage and after seem to chide them. This shall make our purpose necessary and not envious. Which so appearing to the common eyes, we shall be called purgers, not murderers.
And as for Robert Kennedy, think not of him, for he can do no more than Jack's arm when Jack's head is off.
Yet I fear him, for in the engrafted love he bears to Jack.
Alas, good Edgar, think not of him. If he loved the president, all that he can do is to himself take thought and die for Jack. And that were much he should, for he is given to sports, to wildness, and much company.
There is no fear in him. Let him not die, for he will live and hold his tongue hereafter.
The morning comes upon us. We leave you, Lyndon. And friends, disperse yourselves. But all remember what we have said here. Show yourselves true Americans.
Good gentlemen. Look fresh and merrily. Let not our looks put on our purposes, but bear it as our American actors do, with untired spirit and formal constancy. So, good morrow to you, everyone. Boy? Oswald! Fast asleep. That is no matter. Enjoy the honey-heavy dew of slumber. Thou hast no figures and no fantasies that busy care grows in the brains of men. Therefore thou sleepst so sound.
Lyndon, my love.
Ladybird, what mean you? Wherefore rise you now? It is not for your health thus to commit your weak condition to the raw cold morning.
Nor for yours neither. You have ungently, Lyndon, stole from your bed. And yesternight at supper you suddenly arose and walked about, musing and sighing with your arms across. And when I asked you what the matter was, you stared upon me with ungentle looks. I urged you further, then you scratched your head and too impatiently stamped with your foot. Yet I insisted. Yet you answered not, but with an angry wafture of your hand gave sign for me to leave you. So I did. Fearing to strengthen that impatience which seemed too much enkindled, and withal, hoping it was but an effect of humor, which sometime hath his hour with every man. It will not let you eat, nor talk, nor sleep. And could it work so much upon your shape, as it hath much prevailed on your condition, I should not know you, Lyndon. Dear my love. Make me acquainted with your cause of grief.
I'm not well in health, and that is all.
Lyndon is wise, and were he not in health, he would embrace the means to come by it.
Why, so I do. Good lady, go to bed.
Is Lyndon sick? And is it physical to walk unbraced? Suck up the humors of the dank morning? What? Is Lyndon sick? And will he steal out of his wholesome bed to dare the vile contagion of the night and tempt the roomy and unpurged air to add unto his sickness? No, my Lyndon. You have some sick offense within your mind, which by the right and virtue of my place, I ought to know of. Upon my knees, I charm you by my once commended beauty, by all your vows of love, and by that great vow which did incorporate and make us one, that you unfold to me yourself, your half, why you are heavy, and what men tonight have had resort to you? For here have been some six or seven who did hide their faces even from darkness.
May you not, gentle lady.
Well, I should not need if you were gentle, Lyndon. Within the bond of marriage, tell me, Lyndon, is it accepted I should know no secrets that appertain to you? Am I yourself, but as it were, in sort or limitation, to keep with you at meals, comfort your bed, and talk to you sometimes? Dwell I but in the suburbs of your good pleasure? If it be no more, Lady Bird is Lyndon's harlot, not his wife.
You are my true and honorable wife. As dear to me as are the ruddy drops that visit my sad heart.
If this were true, then I should know this secret. I grant I am a woman, but withal, a woman Lyndon Johnson took to wife. I grant I am a woman, but withal, a woman well reputed, Jefferson's daughter. Think you I am no stronger than my sex, being so fathered and so husbanded? Tell me your secrets. I will not disclose them.
One knocks. Lady, go in a while, and by thy bosom shall partake the secrets of my heart.
In his sleep, cried out, "My God, they killed Jack." Who's the name?
Whitney, you Jack. Think you to walk forth? You shall not stir out of your house today.
Kennedy shall go forth, for the things that threaten me ne'er look but on my back. When they shall see the face of Jack Kennedy, they're vanished.
Jack, I never stood on ceremonies, yet now they fright me. A lioness hath whelped in the streets, and graves have yawned and yielded up their dead. Fierce firing warriors fought upon the clouds in ranks and squadrons in right form of war, which drizzled blood upon the capital. The noise of battle hurtled in the air, horses did neigh, and dying men did groan, and ghosts did shriek and squeal about the streets. Oh, Jack, these things are beyond all use, and I do fear them.
If what can be avoided, whose end is purposed by Almighty God. Yet Kennedy shall go forth, for these predictions are to the world in general as to Kennedy.
When bakers die, there are no comets seen. Heaven itself blazes forth the death of princes.
Cowards die many times before their deaths. The valiant never taste of death but once. Of all the wonders I have heard, it seems to me most strange that men should fear, seeing that death, a necessary end, will come when it will come. Jack should be a beast without a heart if he should stay at home today for fear. No, Kennedy shall not. Danger knows full well that Jack is more dangerous than he. With two lions littered in one day, and I, the elder, more terrible than Kennedy, shall go forth.
Alas, my lord, your wisdom is consumed in confidence. Do not go forth today. Call it my fear that keeps you in the house and not your own. We'll send Bobby to the governor, and he shall say, you're not well today. Let me upon my knee prevail in this.
Bobby shall say I am not well, and for thy humor I shall stay at home today. See, here's MacGeorge Bundy. He should tell them so.
Kennedy, all hail, good morrow, worthy Kennedy. I come to fetch you to the motorcade.
And you're coming very happy time to bear my greeting to the Texans and tell them I will not come today. Cannot is false, that I dare not falser. I will not come today. Go tell them so, Mac.
Say he is sick.
Shall John F. send a lie? Have I in Congress stretched mine arms so far to be afeard to tell graybeards the truth? Mac, you go let them know Kennedy will not come today.
But, Mr. President, let me know some cause, lest I be laughed at when I tell them so.
Well, the cause is my will. I will not come today. That's enough to satisfy the Texans. But for thy private satisfaction, and because I love you, I will let you know. Jackie here, my wife, stays me at home. She had a dream tonight. She saw my statue, which like a fountain with 100 spouts did run pure blood, and many lusty folks came smiling and did bathe their hands in it. And these does she apply as warnings, portents, and evils imminent, and on her knee hath begged me stay at home today.
This dream is all a misinterpreted. It was a vision fair and fortunate. Your statue, spouting blood in many pipes in which so many Americans bathed, signifies that from you the United States shall suck reviving blood, and that great men shall press for tinctures, stains, relics, and cognizance. This, by the First Lady's dream, is signified.
And in this way have you well expounded on it.
I have, when you have heard what I can say and know it now. Besides, it were a mock apt to be rendered for someone to say, break up the motorcade till another time when Kennedy's wife shall meet with better dreams.
If Kennedy hide himself, shall they not whisper? Lo, Kennedy is afraid.
Pardon me, Mr. President, for my dear, dear love to your proceedings bids me tell you this, and reason to my love is liable.
How foolish do your fears seem now, Jackie? I'm ashamed I didn't yield to them. Go get my coat, for I will go. And look where Governor Connolly comes to fetch me.
Good morrow, Jack.
Welcome, Governor Connolly. What, Linda, knock thou stirs early too? What is the clock?
Well, can't you struck an eight?
Thank you for your pains and courtesy. See, Robert, who revels longer nights is not with standing up. Good morrow, Bobby.
So too, my dear brother Jack.
Bid them prepare within. I am to blame to be thus waited for, and we, like friends, will straightway go to doubts. And don't be too long in painting your face.
And battlements, to towers and windows, yearning a chimney top with your infants in your arms, and there you have sat the livelong day with patient expectation to see Grand Nixon pass the streets of Dallas. And when you saw his limousine but appear, have you not made a universal shout? The Trinity trembled underneath her banks to hear the replication of your sound, made in her concave shores. And do you now put on your best attire? And do you now call out a holiday? And do you now strew flowers in his way that comes in triumph over Nixon's blood? Oh, be gone! Run to your houses, fall upon your knees, pray to your God to intermit this plague that needs must slash this ingratitude. Gods, go, good country, and for this fault assemble all the poor men of your sort, and draw them to the Trinity banks, and weep your tears into the channel, until the lowest stream do kiss the most exalted shores of all. Run to your houses, fall on your knees, pray to your God!
What are you doing? Beware of Johnson. Take heed of Hoover.
Come not near Alan Dulles.
Have an eye to Clint Murchison? Trust not with George Bundy. Mark well Marcello. There is but one mind in all these men, and it is bent against John Kennedy. If thou beest not immortal, look about you. Security gives way to conspiracy. Almighty God defend thee. Thy servant, Evelyn Lincoln. My heart laments that virtue cannot live out of the teeth of emulation.
Well, I prithee leave her under the motorcade. Stay not to answer me, but get thee gone. Why dost thou stay?
To know my errand, madam.
I would have had thee there and here again ere I can tell thee what thou shouldst do there. Oh, Constancy, be strong upon my side. It's a huge mountain between my heart and tongue. I have a man's mind, but a woman's might. How hard it is for women to keep counsel. Art thou here yet?
Madam, what should I do? Run to Dealey Plaza and nothing else, and then so return to you, and nothing else.
Yes. Bring me word, boy, if thy lord look well, for he went sicker forth. And take good note what Kennedy doth, suit pressed to him. What noise is that?
I hear none, ma'am.
Prithee, listen well. I heard a bustling rumor, like a fray. And the wind brings it from Dealey Plaza. What is it, o'clock?
About the ninth hour, lady.
Is the president yet gone to the trademark?
Madam, not yet. I go to take my stand to see him pass on from Lovefield.
Thou hast some suit to the president, hast thou not?
That I have, lady. If it will please the president to be so good to Kennedy as to hear me, I shall beseech him to befriend himself.
Why? Knowest thou any harms intended towards him?
None that I know will be much that I fear may chance. Good morrow to you.
I must go in. Ah, me. How weak a thing the heart of a woman is. Oh, Linden. The heavens speed thee in thine enterprise. Run, Oswald, and commend me to my lord. Say, I am Mary. Come to me again, and bring me word what he doth say to thee.
Desire you to o'er him, at your best leisure, his so humble suit.
Oh, Mr. President, read mine first, for mine's a suit that touches Kennedy nearer. Read it, great Kennedy.
That which touches ourselves shall be last served.
Delay not, Mr. President, read it instantly.
What is it, lady man?
Madam, give place.
What? Urge you your petitions in the street, go to the trademark.
I wish your enterprise today may thrive.
What enterprise, Governor?
Very well.
What said Governor Connor?
He wished today our enterprise might thrive. I fear our purpose is discover it.
Look how he makes to Kennedy, mark him.
Dulles, be sudden, for we fear prevention. Linden, what shall be done? If this be known, Hoover or Kennedy never shall turn back, for I will slay myself.
Edgar, be constant. Connolly speaks not of our purposes, for look, he smiles, and Kennedy does not change.
Bundy knows his time, for look you, Linden, he draws Bobby out of the way.
Are we all ready? What is now amiss that John F. Kennedy must redress?
Most high, most mighty, most puissant Kennedy, cause my soul throws before thy seat and humble heart.
I must prevent thee, Marcello. These couchings and these lowly courtesies might fire the blood of ordinary men and turn preordinates in first degree to the law of children. Be not far to think that Kennedy bears such rebel blood that will be thawed from that true quality with that which melted fools. I mean sweet words, low crooked curtsies, and base spaniel fawning. Carlos Marcello, by decree, is banished! If thou dost bend and fawn and pray for mercy, I spurn thee like a cur out of my way. No, Kennedy doth not wrong, nor without cause will he be satisfied.
Is there no voice more worded than my own, that sound more sweetly in great Kennedy's ear, following appeal of my deportation?
Mr. President, I must speak too, desiring thee that Carlos Marcello may have an immediate freedom of repeal.
What, Lyndon?
Pardon, Mr. President.
Jack.
Pardon. As low as thy foot on Hoover fall, to beg enfranchisement for Carlos Marcello.
I could be well moved if I were as you. If I could pray to move, prayers would move me, but I'm constant as the northern star, of whose true fixed and resting quality there is no fellow in the firmament. The skies are painted with unnumbered sparks. They are all fire, and every one doth shine. But there's but one and all doth hold his place. So in the world, 'tis furnished well with men, and men are flesh and blood and apprehensive. Yet in that number I do know of one that unassailable holds on his rank, unshaked of motion, and that I am he. Let me a little show it even in this, that I was constant, Marcello should be banished, and constant do remain to keep him so.
Confounded with this mutiny.
Stand fast together, at least some friend of the Kennedy should join us.
Talk not of standing. Good cheer, Governor. There is no harm intended to your person nor no American else. So tell them, Governor.
Men, wives, and children, stare, cry out, and run as it would doomsday.
Fates, we will know your pleasures. That we shall die, we know. 'Tis but the time and drawing days out that men stand upon.
Cuts off 20 years of life, cuts off so many years of fearing death.
Grant that, and then is death a benefit? So are we Kennedy's friends, that have abridged his time of fearing death. Stoop, Americans, stoop. Let's bathe our hands in Kennedy's blood up to the elbows. Let's all cry peace, freedom, and liberty.
Stoop then, and wash.
How many ages hence shall this our lofty scene be acted over in states unborn and accents yet unknown?
How many times must Kennedy bleed in sport that now on daily's basis lies along no worthier than the dust?
So oft as that shall be, so often shall this none of us be called the men that gave their country liberty.
What? Shall we forth?
Aye. Every man away.
I know not what you intend, gentlemen. Who else must be let blood? Who else's rank? If I myself, there is no hour so fit as Jack's death's hour, nor no instrument of half that worth as those your swords made rich with the most noble blood of all this world. I do beseech thee, if you bear me hard, now, whilst your purpled hands do reek in smoke, fulfill your pleasure! Live a thousand days, I shall not find myself so apt to die. No place will please me so, no means of death, as here by Jack, and by you cut off, the choice and master spirits of this age.
Robert, make not your death of us. Though now we must appear bloody and cruel as by our hands, and this the present act you see we do, yet you see but our hands, and the bleeding business they have done. Our hearts you see not. They are pitiful, and pity to the general wrong of the U.S. As fire drives out fire, so pity hath done this deed on Jack. For your part, to you, our swords have leaden points, Bobby. Our arms in strength of malice, and our hearts of brother's temper, to receive you in all kind love, good thoughts, and reverence.
Your voice shall be as strong as any man's in the disposing of new dignities.
Only be patient till we have appeased the multitude beside themselves with fear. And then we will deliver you the cause why I, that is of Jack, when I struck him, have thus proceeded.
I doubt not your wisdom. Gentlemen all, alas, what shall I say? My credit now stands on such slippery ground that one of two bad ways you must concede to me, either a coward, a flatterer. That I did love thee, Jack, oh, 'tis true. If then thy spirit look upon us now, shall it grieve thee dearer than thy death to see thy brother making his peace, shaking the fingers of thy foes most noble at the presence of thy course? Had I as many eyes as thou hast wounds, weeping as fast as they stream forth thy blood, it would become me better than to close in terms of friendship with thine enemies. Pardon me, Charlie. It was thou bait, brave heart. It is thou fall. And here thy hunters stand, signed in thy spoil and crimson thy lethe. Your world, thou hast the forest to this arm. And this indeed, O world, the heart of thee. Like a deer struck by many princes, dost thou here lie?
Robert.
Pardon me, Edgar. The enemies of the president shall say this, then in a brother it is called modesty.
I blame you not for praising Jack so, but what compact mean you to have with us? Will you be pricked in number of our friends, or shall we on and not depend on you?
Therefore I took your hands, but was indeed swayed from the point by looking down upon Jack. Friends, am I with you all? And love you all.
Upon this oath, that you shall give me reasons why and wherein Jack was dangerous.
Else were this a savage spectacle. Our reasons are so full of good regard that were you Bobby the son of John, you would be satisfied.
That's all I see. And am more of a sooner that I may produce his body to the capital, and in the pulpit his becomes a friend speak in the order of his funeral.
You shall, Robert.
Lyndon, a word with you. You know not what you do. Do not consent to let Bobby speak in his funeral. Know you how much the people may be moved by that which he will utter?
By your pardon, I will myself unto the pulpit first and show reason of our president's death.
I know not what may fall. I like it not!
Bobby, here. Take you Jack's body. You shall not in your funeral speech blame us, but speak all good you can devise of the former president, and say you do it by our permission. Else shall you not have any hand at all about his funeral. You shall speak in the same pulpit whereto I am going, and after my speech is ended.
Be it so. I do desire no more.
Prepare you the body, then, and follow us.
Oh, pardon me. O bleeding piece of earth, that I am meek and gentle with these butchers. Thou art the ruins of the noblest man that ever lived in the tide of times. Woe to the hands that shed this costly blood. Over thy wounds now do I prophesy, which like dumb mouths do ope their ruby lips and beg the voice and utterance of my tongue. A curse shall light upon the limbs of men. Domestic fury and fierce civil strife shall cumber all the parts of Vietnam. Blood and destruction shall be so in use, and dreadful objects so familiar that mothers shall but smile when they see their infants quartered with the hands of war, or pity choked with the custom of fell deeds. And Jack's spirit, raging with revenge, with Lincoln by his side, come hot from hell, shall in these confines with a monarch's voice cry havoc and let slip the dogs of war, that this foul deed shall smell above the earth with carrion men groaning for burial.
Thank you. Americans. All I have, I would have given gladly not to be standing here today. John Fitzgerald Kennedy lives on in the immortal words and works he left behind. He lives on in the mind and memories of mankind. He lives on in the hearts of his countrymen. There are no words sad enough to express our sense of loss. There are no words strong enough to express our determination to continue the forward thrust of America that he began. Under John Kennedy's leadership, this nation has shown that we have the courage to seek peace. We have shown that we can also be a formidable foe to those who would reject the path of peace and those who would seek to impose upon us or our allies the yoke of tyranny. An assassin's bullet has thrust upon me the awesome burden of the presidency. I am here today to say that I need your help. I cannot bear this burden alone. As Jack loved me, I weep for him. As he was fortunate, I rejoice at it. As he was valiant, I honor him. But as he was ambitious, I mourn him. There's tears for his love, joy for his fortune, honor for his valor, and death for his ambition. This nation has experienced a profound shock. And in this critical moment, it is our duty to show that from the brutal loss of our leader, we derive not weakness, but strength, that we can and will act, and act now. On the 20th day of January, in 1961, John F. Kennedy told his countrymen that our national work would not be finished in the first 1,000 days, nor in the life of this administration, nor even perhaps in our lifetime on this planet. But, he said, let us begin. Today, in this moment of new resolve, I would say to all my fellow Americans, let us continue. My countrymen, I do entreat you, not a man depart save I alone until Mr. Robert Kennedy have spoken.
Friends, Americans, countrymen. In me arrears, I come to bury Jack, not to praise him. The evil that men do lives after them. The good is often tarried with their bones, so let it be with Jack. A noble leader hath told you Jack was ambitious. If it were so, it was a grievous act, and grievously hath he answered it. Here under the leave of Johnson and the rest, for Johnson is an honorable man. So are they all honorable men, come I to speak here at Jack's funeral. He was my friend, faithful and just to me. Yet Johnson says he was ambitious, and Lyndon is an honorable man. When that the poor hath cried, Jack hath wept. Ambition should be made of sterner stuff. Yet Johnson says he was ambitious, and Lyndon is an honorable man. I speak not to disprove what the president spoke, but here I am to speak of what I do know. There would be my heart's in the coffin there with Jack, and I must pause till it come back to me. But yesterday, the word of John F. Kennedy might have stood against the world. Now lies he there, and none so poor to do him reverence. Oh, masters, were I to stir your hearts and minds to mutiny and rage, it should do Johnson wrong, and Hoover wrong, who, as you all know, are honorable men. I will not do them wrong. I rather choose to wrong the dead, to wrong myself and to wrong you, than I will wrong such honorable men. They that have done this deed are wise and honorable. What private griefs they have, alas, I know not that made them do it. They are wise and honorable, and will no doubt with reasons answer you. I speak not, friends, to steal away your hearts, for I am no orator as Johnson is, but as you know me all well, a plain but blunt man that love my brother, and that they know full well gave me public leave to speak of him. For I have neither wit, nor words, worth, action, nor utterance, nor the power of speech to stir men's blood. I only speak right on. I tell you that which you yourselves do know. Show you sweet Johnny's wounds, poor, poor, dumb mouths, and bid them speak for me. But were I Johnson and Johnson Bobby, their reckoning would ruffle up your spirits and put a tongue in every wound of Jack that should move the stones of America to rise in mutiny. We'll fetch fire. You serve Dr. King, do you not?
I do, Mr. Kennedy.
I did right for him to come to Washington.
Sir, Dr. King's already come to Washington.
He comes upon a wish. Fortune is merry, and this wound mood will give us anything.
In fact, 45 major bills were passed. When American destroyers were attacked in the Gulf of Tonkin, he replied firmly and decisively, and communist aggression was turned back. In the dark days of last November, President Johnson expressed the nation's purpose in three simple words. Let us continue. Vote for President Johnson on November 3rd. The stakes are too high for you to stay home.
What now, Jack Valenti? Is Hoover there?
He is at hand, and Tolson has come to do you salutation from his master.
He greets me well. Your master, Clyde, in his own change or by ill officers, has given me worthy cause to wish things be undone. But if he be at hand, I shall be satisfied.
I have no doubt but that my noble master will appear, such as he is, full of regard and honor.
He's not doubted. A word, Valenti.
Now he received you, let me be resolved.
With courtesy and with respect enough, but not with such free and friendly conference as he hath us of old.
Thou hast described a hot friend cooling. Ever note, Valenti, when love begins to sicken and decay, it uses an enforcing ceremony. There are no tricks in plain and simple faith!
Most noble brother, you have done me wrong! Judge me!
My God! Do I wrong mine enemies? And if that's so, how should I wrong a brother?
Lyndon, this sober form of yours hides wrongs, and you be content. Speak your grief softly.
I do know you well.
That you have wronged me doth appear in this. You have condemned and fired Walter Jenkins, wherein my letter praying on his side was slighted off.
You wrong yourself to write in such a case.
In such a time as this, it is not meet that every knight's offense should bear your comment.
The name of Hoover honors this corruption, and chastisement doth therefore hide his head.
Chastisement?
Remember November 22nd? Did that great Kennedy bleed for justice sake? What villain touched his body that did plot and not for justice? What? Shall one of us that struck the foremost man of all this world contaminate our fingers with base deeds and sell the modest faces of our large honors for so much trash as may be grasped thus? I'd rather be a dog and bear at the moon than such an American.
Lyndon, bait not me. I'll not endure it. You forget yourself to hitch me in. I am a soldier. I, older in practice, abler than yourself to make conditions.
Go to. You are not, Edgar.
I am.
I say you are not.
Push me no more. I shall forget myself. Have mind upon your health. Tempt me no farther.
Away, slight man.
Is possible?
Hear me, for I will speak. Must I make way and room for your rash caller? Shall I be frightened when a madman stares?
Oh, my God, must I endure all this?
All this, and more. Fret till your proud heart break. Go show your slaves how choleric you are, and make bondmen tremble. Must I budge? Must I observe you? Must I stand and crouch under your testy humor? For from this day forth, I shall use you for my mirth. Yea, for my laughter when you are waspish.
Is it come to this?
You say you are a better soldier. Let it appear so. Make your vaunting true.
You wrong me every way. You wrong me, Lyndon. I said an elder soldier, not a better. Did I say better?
If you did, I care not.
When Kennedy lived, he dared not thus have moved me.
Peace! Peace! You dared not so have tempted him.
I dared not!
No!
What dared not tempt him?
For your life, you dared not!
Do not presume too much upon my love! I may do that I shall be sorry for!
You have done that you should be sorry for! There is no terror, Edgar, in your threats!
A friend should bear his friend's infirmities, but Johnson makes mine greater than they are!
I do not till you practice them on me!
You love me not.
I do not like your faults.
A friendly eye could never see such faults.
A flatterer's would not, though they do appear as huge as the Washington Monument.
Come! Bobby Kennedy and Martin Luther King, come! Revenge yourselves alone on Hoover! The Hoover is a weary of this world, hated by
for I know when thou didst hate him worst, thou lovest him better than ever thou lovest me.
Put away your gun. Be angry when you will. It shall have scope. Do what you will. Dishonor shall be humor. Oh, Edgar, you are yoked with a lamb that carries anger as the flint bears fire, who much enforcing shows a hasty spark and straight is cold again.
Who will live to be but rash humor to his president when grief and blood ill-tempered vexed him?
When I spoke that, I was ill-tempered too.
Do you confess so much? Oh, give me your hand.
Oh. And my heart too.
Oh, Lyndon.
What's the matter?
Have not you love enough to bear with me when this rash humor which my mother gave me makes me forgetful?
Yes. And from henceforth, when you are over earnest with your president, he'll think your mother chides and leaves you so.
My heart is thirsty for that noble pledge. I cannot drink too much of Lyndon's love.
Come in, Tolson. Welcome, good Valente. Valente, I have here received letters that young Kennedy and Dr. King come down upon us with a mighty power, bending their expedition toward Montgomery. What do you think of marching to Montgomery presently?
I do not think it good.
Your reason?
This it is. 'Tis better that the enemy seek us. Thus shall he waste his means, weary his soldiers, doing himself offense, whilst we, lying still, are full of rest, defense, and nimbleness.
Good reasons must by force give place to better. The people twixt Montgomery and Selma do stand but of forced affection. For they have grudged us contribution. Reverend King marching along by them make a fuller number up, come on refreshed, new added, and encouraged. From this advantage shall we cut him off. If at the Pettus Bridge we face him there, these people at our back.
Hear me, good brother.
Under your pardon! You must note beside that we have tried the utmost of our friends. Our legions are brimful, our cause is ripe. The enemy increaseth every day. We at the height are ready to decline. There's a tide in the affairs of men, which taken at the flood leads on to fortune. Omitted, all the voyage of their life is bound in shallows and in miseries. Unto such a full sea are we now afloat, and we must take the current as it serves, or lose our ventures.
Then we'll meet them at Montgomery.
Now, Bobby, our hopes are answered. You said the enemy would not come down, but keep to the hills and upper regions. It proves not so. Their battles are at hand. They mean to warn us at Pettus Bridge here, answering before we do demand of them.
Look, I am in their bosoms and know wherefore they do it. They could be content to visit other places and come down with fearful bravery, thinking by this face to fasten in our thoughts that they have courage. But 'tis not so.
Agree, gentlemen.
Dr. King, shall we give sign of battle?
No. We will answer on their charge.
Stir not until the call.
Words before blows. Is it so, countrymen?
Not that we love words better, as you do.
Good words are better than bad strokes, Dr. King.
In your bad strokes, you give good words, Lyndon. Witness the hold you made in Jack's head, crying, "Long live Hail Kennedy!"
Bobby, the posture of your blows is yet unknown, but for your
very wisely threat before you stand!
Villains, you did not so when your vile words hacked one another in the head of my brother. You showed your teeth like apes, you fawned like hounds, you bowed like bondsmen, kissing Jack's feet, you flatterers.
Oh, flatterers! Now, Lyndon, thank yourself. This tongue had not offended so today, Hoover might have ruled.
Come the cause. If arguing make us sweat, the proof of it will turn to redder drops.
I hold a hand against conspirators. When think you the hand goes up again? Never till Jack's many wounds be well avenged, or till another Kennedy hath added slaughter to the sword of traitors.
No, Bobby, thou canst not die by traitors' hands, unless thou bring'st them with thee.
Well, so I hope. I was not born to die on Johnson's sword.
Oh, if thou wert the noblest of thy strain, young man, thou couldst not die more honorable.
A peevish schoolboy, unworthy of such honors, joined by a masquer and a reveler.
Oh, Edgar, still.
Come, Bobby, away. Defiance, traitors, hurl we in your teeth. If you dare fight today, come to the bridge. If not, when you have stomachs.
Turn me around, turn me around, turn me around, ain't gonna let nobody. Turn me around, I'm gonna keep on a walking, keep on a talking, marching up to freedom land. Ain't gonna let no jailhouse turn. Turn me round, ain't gonna let nobody.
I'm not sure. The Viet Cong did not win by a knockout, but neither did we. The referees of history may make it a draw. This summer's almost certain standoff will either end in real give and take negotiations or terrible escalation. And for every means we have to escalate, the enemy can match us. And that applies to invasion of the North, the use of nuclear weapons, or the mere commitment of 100 or 200 or 300,000 more American troops to the battle. And with each escalation, the world comes closer to the brink of cosmic disaster. On the off chance that military and political analysts are right, in the next few months we must test the enemy's intentions in case this is indeed his last big gasp before negotiations. But it is increasingly clear to this report that the only rational way out then will be to negotiate, not as victors, but as an honorable people who lived up to their pledge to defend democracy and did the best they could. This is Walter Grand Guide. Good night.
Yet, countrymen, oh yet, hold up your heads.
The polls are in. Tell Kennedy Johnson's taken.
I'll tell the news. Here comes the candidate. The president is taken. Johnson is taken.
Yeah, buddy. I dare assure thee, no opponent shall ever take alive the noble Johnson. God will defend him so great a shame. And when you do find him, or alive or dead, you will be found like Johnson, like himself. I'm announcing today my candidacy for the presidency of the United States. I do not run for the presidency merely to oppose any man, but to propose new policies. I run because I am convinced that this country is on a perilous course, and I have such strong feelings about what must be done, and I feel obliged to do all that I can. Yeah.
Come hither, good Valente, list a word.
Say you're your president.
Well, it's Jack. The ghost of Kennedy hath appeared to me, too, several times by night. I know my hour has come.
Not so, dear sir.
Nay, I'm sure it is, Valente. Thou seest the world, Jack, how it goes. The enemy has beat us to the pit. It is more worthy to leap in ourselves than tear it till they push us. Farewell to you, Valente. I shall have glory by this losing day more than Dr. Kang and Robert Kennedy by this foul quest shall attain unto. There you will at once. For Johnson's tongue hath almost ended his life's history. Night hangs upon mine eyes. My bones would rest that have but labored to attain this hour. With America's sons in the fields far away, with America's future under challenge right here at home, with our hopes and the world's hopes for peace in the balance every day, I do not believe that I can devote an hour or a day of my time to any personal partisan cause or duty other than the awesome duties of this office, the presidency of your country. Accordingly, I shall not seek, and I will not accept the nomination of my party for another term as your president.
Yes! Yes.
Farewell, good Valente. Kennedy, now be still.
Johnson only overcame himself, and no man else hath honor but he. all the conspirators, save only he, did that that they did, from greed and revenge. He only, in a general honest thought and common good to all, made one of them. His life was gentle, and the elements so mixed in him that nature might stand up and say to all the world, this was a man. According to his virtue, let us use him, with all respect, with rites of passage.
We want Bobby. 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 We want Bobby.
What I think is clear is that we can work together in the last analysis. And what has been going on in the United States over a period of the last 3 years, the divisions, the violence, the disenchantment with our society, the divisions, whether it's between the blacks and the whites, or between the poor and the more affluent, or between age groups, or on the war on Vietnam, is that we can work together. We are a great country, an unselfish country, and a compassionate country. I intend to make that my basis for running. All, and now it's on to Chicago, and let's win from there.
Yeah! RFK! 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 Rah, rah, rah! Kennedy! Kennedy! Sis boom bah! Kennedy! Kennedy! Rah, rah, rah! Kennedy! Kennedy! Sis boom bah! Kennedy! Kennedy! Rah, rah, rah!
For president who's seasoned through and through, but not so doggone seasoned that he won't try something new. A man who's old enough to know
and young enough to do.
Well, it's up to you, it's up to you, it's strictly up to you.
But it's Kennedy, 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 Kennedy,
Kennedy, Kennedy, Kennedy, Kennedy, Kennedy, Kennedy.
Do you want a man with spirit who is not afraid to fight?
A man whose record shows that he will fight for what is right.
A loyal man who'll bring the job a fresh new point of view.
Well, it's up to you, it's up to you,
it's strictly up to you.
When I was a young man courting the girls, I played me a waiting game. If a maid refused me with tossing curls, I'd let the old earth take a couple of whirls while I plied her with tears in place of pearls. And as time came around, she came my way. As time came around, she came. But it's a long, long while from May to December, and the days grow short when you reach September, and the autumn weather turns the leaves to flame, and I haven't got time for the waiting game. And the days turn to gold as they grow few. September, November, and these few golden days I'd share with you. These golden days I'd share with you. And the wine dwindles down to a precious brew. September, November, and these few vintage years I'd share with you. These vintage years I'd share with you.